this avenue of life, remember those who bowed beneath the strife. Each leaf a laurel crowns with deathless fame, and every tree reveals a hero's name.
No myths or memories in Australia have been more tenaciously maintained than the achievements of the Anzacs and the bloody birth of a nation on the battlefields of the Great War. After the war, memorials to the fallen were erected all around the country. There were imposing cenotaphs, arches and rolls of honour in main streets, town halls, schools and sporting clubs. Lonely stone figures stood grieving over tablets of the fallen. Avenues of honour, trees lining the highways, were planted in suburbs and towns throughout Australia. Australia's official war historian, W. Bean, wrote that the war had illuminated how Australia, with one of the most notable fighting forces in history, had secured a recognisable place amongst the world's nations. Another historian, Ernest Scott, declared that
the war was the pivotal event in the history of Australia.
Australia entered the war as part of the British Empire. Before 1914, there was little argument that when the Empire was under threat, Australia would be there.
Keep your eye on Germany, but England, home and beauty, have no cause to fear. Your old acquaintance be forgot. No, 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 Australia will be there. Australia.
When the war broke out, men rushed to enlist from all over Australia. They came from the countryside, they came from towns, they came from cities and suburbs. And there's been something of a myth in Australia that the men were rural types, that they were resourceful men of the land. But in fact, Lloyd Robson's work has shown quite clearly that the majority of men who enlisted came from the towns, that they were urban men. Men enlisted for a whole variety of reasons. They gave as their reasons things like patriotism, a sense of adventure, they wanted to travel. It's also quite clear that many men also enlisted to escape domestic responsibilities or domestic troubles. For example, we know that many men gave false names on enlistment. We know this because they had to allocate money to their wives and families, those who were married, and many of them seem to have given false names to escape this responsibility. I think this fits into the great Australian tradition of Australian men moving on. There was a long tradition of mobility, and when an adventure or a gold rush or a war breaks out, then you up and go.
In 1901, Rolf Boldrewood, author of Robbery Under Arms, wrote an essay on the Australian native-born type. He began by praising the adaptability of the Australian merino. When he moved from sheep to people, he reassured his readers that race was everything.
Australians,
he confidently predicted,
would become Britons of the South when the world's war dogs bay around the sacred standard of the Empire. Australians will be eagerly emulous to be enrolled among the soldiers of the Queen.
such sentiments were vigorously promoted by the Australian branch of the British Empire League. In 1905, it convinced the Premier's Conference to hold an Empire Day celebration every year. Empire Day was to be the 24th of May, the birthday of the late Queen Victoria. It was to be an occasion on which patriotism would be aroused and a common love for the imperial connection strengthened. Empire Day was particularly aimed at school children. In 1907, pupils at Sydney's Cleveland Street School recited, "I give my mind to my country to think for it. I give my heart because I love it. I give my hands to my country to work for it." To which the boys added, "and to fight for it." Learnt about the glories of the Empire through reading adventure stories, well-told ripping yarns, in annuals such as Chums, The Boy's Own, Young Australia, or W.H. Fitchett's Deeds That Won the Empire. First published in 1879, over 100,000 copies of Deeds That Won the Empire were sold. Its author, a Melbourne Methodist minister and headmaster, became a household name throughout the empire. Australian girls had their own annuals. They also devoured the novels of Ethel Turner and Mary Grant Bruce, especially her Billabong series. In these, God was in heaven, wars always ended in victory for the right side, droughts broke just in time, and England was called home by middle-class Australian families. Not all Australians supported the Empire Day message. On the eve of the first Empire Day, the Sydney Bulletin said that
the children would mark this official feast day of St. Jingo by singing hymns of blood and battle in glory of a country which is not their own.
Many Catholic clergy objected to the Protestant nature of the celebrations. On Empire Day in 1911, St. Mary's Cathedral in Sydney flew the flags of Ireland and Australia, but not the Union Jack. This led to an outcry in the press. The majority of Australians, however, were right behind the incoming Labour Prime Minister, Andrew Fisher, who, while still on the election trail in July 1914, prayed that
a disastrous war may be averted. But should the worst happen, after everything has been done that honour will permit, Australians will stand behind our own to help and defend her to the last man and the last shilling. The dogs of war are loose in Europe, and a nice noise they're making. It was started by a dachshund that's thought to have gone mad. Though there was so much method in his madness that this is doubtful. Mated with the dachshund, for better or for worse, was an Austrian mongrel. The dachshund, to his annoyance, found only one friend, and that was a dog of Constantinople. The dogs of Constantinople are quite well known for being fond of offal. Meanwhile, the rest of the European happy family looked on, and who shall say how the row will spread?
Australia had already made some preparations for war, but defence of the new nation was based upon deference to the mother country. Arrangements had been made in 1911 for British control of the Royal Australian Navy in wartime. More initiative was shown with the army, Compulsory training for boys between 12 and 18 began in 1909. A number of these were early volunteers in the first AIF. Possibly as many as 15% of the force were former boy soldiers. In the first months of the war, enthusiastic and successful recruiting meetings were held all around Australia. The first contingent of the AIF, the Australian Imperial Force, was recruited very quickly. Australians showed their almost total support for a war being fought 10,000 miles away.
If England wants a hand, well, here it is. If England wants a hand, well, here it is.
The bugles of England were blowing o'er the sea, as they had called 1,000 years, calling now to me. They woke me from dreaming in the dawning of the day. The bugles of England, and how could I stay? The banners of England unfurled across the sea, floating out upon the wind, were beckoning to me. Storm-rent and battle-torn, smoke-stained and grey, the banners of England, and how could I stay? O England, I heard the cry of those who died for thee, sounding like an organ voice across the winter sea. They lived and died for England and gladly went their way. England, O England, how could I stay?
J.D. Burns wrote this for the Scotch Collegian, his old Melbourne school magazine. He was killed in action at Gallipoli. Another volunteer, a farmer in the Light Horse, wrote shortly after the landing at Anzac Cove,
God grant that men realize the greatness of this project, and whatever the sacrifice, make it, in order that our grand old flag may still wave over a united empire.
The Great War, in particular the Gallipoli campaign of 1915, and the battles of the Western Front in France and Belgium, was an initiation into trench warfare for the Australian forces. It also provided growing evidence of the desolating horrors of war. As tens of thousands of Australians died, the war became increasingly to seem without end or purpose. In 1915, Andrew Fisher resigned as Prime Minister. His replacement was William Morris Hughes.
Although when the war broke out, there seemed to be no shortage of enlistments, by 1915 it was clear that there was a considerable gap between the demands of imperial authorities and the willingness of Australian men to come forward in sufficient numbers. Therefore, from about the middle of that year, from the middle of 1915, there was the first concerted official recruiting campaign in order to pressure men to go to the front. Primarily, it was the threat of a sense that they weren't manly, that they were suggesting that these men weren't true men, and they did this by a variety of means. They either appealed to men as men to be loyal to their mates, or they appealed to men to be sportsmen and to play the game of cricket, football or the war, and to join up in sportsmen's 1000s. The authorities were very keen on women to exercise their influence, their feminine influence, to bring men to a sense of their masculine duty. So in Queensland, for example, there were examples of women being told, when a man steps forth to ask you for a dance, you must politely refuse him and tell him that he's a shirker and that women don't dance with shirkers and his place is at the front.
Prime Minister Billy Hughes increased the propaganda to encourage men to join up. Appearing in the bulletin, Norman Lindsay's cartoon showed alleged atrocities committed by the German Hun, particularly on innocent women and children. The message was clear. The same things could happen here if the Germans triumphed. Propaganda like this created a strong anti-German feeling on the home front. German residents were persecuted and Teutonic place names changed. Bismarck in Tasmania became Collinsvale. Germantown in New South Wales became Holbrook.
Australian enlistments in the First World War were extremely high. One out of every two eligible men, in fact, voluntarily enlisted to go to the front. And I think this is an incredible figure. However, this was not enough from the point of view of the imperial authorities, who clearly saw Australian men as cannon fodder. And as the Allies became more bogged down in the battles on the Western Front, Hughes was called upon to provide yet more men than those who were willing to come voluntarily. And after he conferred with the imperial authorities in London in 1916, he returned to Australia determined to introduce one way or another conscription.
When Billy Hughes decided that he wasn't getting enough volunteer soldiers and that he was going to have to introduce conscription, he had a political problem. His political problem essentially was that his party had very mixed feelings about conscription. Trade unionists and others said that if you're going to have conscription of people, then you ought to at least consider conscription of wealth. His method of dealing with this problem was to go to a referendum. He was in a sense appealing above the heads of his party. If he could get national support for his proposal, then his party would just have to accept it. He had considerable support when he did this too. The great majority of the press was with him, the great majority of the churches. The great bulwarks of respectable opinion were convinced that Australia had to play its part in the Great War, and if it couldn't do that by volunteers, it had to do it with conscripts. Was it really necessary? He'd been urged earlier in 1916, when he'd gone to Britain, he'd been urged that the other combatants were introducing conscription and Australia really ought to do so as well. The numbers of volunteers were falling off, and indeed the losses were outnumbering the volunteers. So if he wanted to build up the Australian Imperial Force, he certainly had to find some other way of filling the ranks.
bright midday in the city street, when the troops...
The conscription issue bitterly divided the community. Opponents included a majority of Labour Party supporters. They forced Billy Hughes and his followers out of the party. Trade unionists also opposed conscription for overseas service. The more radical of them regarded the war as a conflict between capitalists, a bosses' war, in which the working classes were being sacrificed on the battlefields.
Marching for the dear old homeland, marching for the mother country soul, leaving the homeland dear one, with hearts beating strong and true, knowing well that danger lay before them, they fought till they fell and died, for the honor and the glory of the empire.
One of the leaders against conscription was the Roman Catholic Archbishop of Melbourne, Daniel Mannix. He was accused of disloyalty to king and country, as was the Irish Catholic community which he supposedly represented. The result of the conscription referendum was a narrow defeat for Hughes. To the surprise of some, and to Hughes's consternation, only a small majority of soldiers on active service voted for conscription. The Labour Party split over the issue. It was replaced in government by the Nationalist Party, led by Hughes. The Labour Party would remain out of office until 1929. At the end of 1917, a second referendum was more clearly defeated. But for the troops, the terrible Battle of Passchendaele was of more moment than the bitter debate raging at home. By the time the war ended, on November the 11th, 1918, nearly 60,000 Australians had died. Another 170,000 were wounded, many suffering permanent injuries.
Marching for their king and country soul, thinking of home and dear one.
The end of the war gave Hughes, the little digger, a chance to strut on the international stage. The peace conference at Versailles was Hughes' chance to play the Australian larrikin at large. Politician and a cartoonist's delight, Hughes' assertion of Australia's independence was sincere but superficial. As a genuine claim, it was hollow and short-lived. Australia would always rely on its allies, Great Britain and the United States, for military and strategic support. While Hughes postured in France, the Australian veterans of war began to come home. Home to a society which their experiences abroad would help to change. Despite their medals and the fanfare at their homecoming, many servicemen would soon feel that they were returning to insufficient gratitude and understanding. Jobs were not always easy to come by, and the empire-wide scheme of settling soldiers on the land was a failure in Australia. The human toll of the Great War weighed on Australia long after the armistice. In his autobiographical novel, My Brother Jack, George Johnson wrote of the hallway of his parents' house.
The whole area of the hall was a clutter of walking sticks with heavy rubber tips and sets of crutches. The sort of tips on walking sticks that relate to injury rather than to elegance. and there was always at least one invalid wheelchair there, and some artificial limbs propped in the corners. Jack and I must have spent a good part of our boyhood in the fixed belief that grown-up men who were complete were pretty rare beings. Complete, that is, in that they had their sight or hearing or all of their limbs.
The outcome of World War I for gender relations in Australia was, as with most wars, contradictory, I think. On the one hand, there was a real celebration of masculinity. You have the birth of a new national hero in the Anzac, who himself had given birth to the nation. And so in that sense, Australian masculinity comes to the fore and attains a significance yet unimagined, I think. There's this contradictory outcome. On the one hand, masculinity is celebrated and women are marginalised in the national culture. On the other hand, there are all sorts of new opportunities open to women, and they will take these opportunities and explore all sorts of new lives, new ways of being.
Australia's dependence on Britain was not undone by the war. In many ways, it was strengthened. The dead became part of a new mythology.
More than 300,000 brave men, between the beginning of the Great War and the time this volume is issued, have volunteered to fight for Australia, for the British Empire and for civilization, against a most barbarous foe. Countless thousands of these gallant Australians may find no other memorial than one brief mention in a casualty list, and perhaps a lonely cross on the rocky peninsula of Gallipoli, or the shifting sand of the desert, or some field of France. They have made their country's name immortal, and they are mourned by those near and dear to them. Thousands of the men who put the word Anzac into all the languages of the world and earned for Australia an imperishable record in the history of the human race.
Participation in the Great War and the memories of it set the beginnings of change in Australia. The beginnings of an independent identity.